So you getting to this dietary restriction without malnutrition, we have a lot to talk about with dietary restriction and its effects on the human physiology. But did you supplement with anything? Was this like, so this 21-day fast, were there any vitamin mineral supplements like
Right.
along with that?
No, and that's the surprising thing. I'll show you my nutrient panel. Even last day with 14 days, my vitamin D went up. It didn't go down. Of course, I was in sunny California, laying in the sun. It was beautiful. I wasn't deficient in anything. All my blood panels turned out normal. On day seven, I did a around-the-clock amino acid panel where I did all the amino acids and the several metabolites that are in there. And of course, they tracked with a circadian day, just like you've talked about. They're not something that are fixed. This idea that we're eating protein and it's pumping in our bloods, it's always there. But they do cycle with the day. Of course, things like alanine, which is mainly used for the gluconeogenesis, went through the roof. Lipids go through the roof. So there's some changes, certainly some physiological changes, but I wasn't deficient in anything. The idea that we have to have nutrition every day and this balanced meal, that's one of the things that I really want to challenge. Because I do think we need a comprehensive nutrient adequacy across the spectrum, but it's probably measured in days or weeks, not every single day.
Yeah, so in terms of like the micronutrients and certain micronutrients that are needed, you're talking about B vitamins, vitamin K, selenium, zinc, magnesium. The question still remains, like, what is an adequate level? Because a lot of the RDAs that are set on based off of animal studies that have been done that have shown that deficiency can cause death. And so like a couple standard deviations above that are what are considered
Right.
what you need.
Right.
But the question is, and this is something that my mentor Bruce Ames has, proposed and put out there, and I know that you're familiar with
Yeah.
something that he calls triage
Right.
theory, and that is, well, there's all these enzymes and proteins that require some of these micronutrients as cofactors that are not essential for short-term survival. So if
Right.
you're deficient in it, it doesn't matter right now because it's not needed right
Right.
now. It's
Right.
needed for a long-term survival. It's needed to repair damage that's constantly happening.
Right.
It's needed to prevent things like cancer, Alzheimer's disease. So the question of deficiency in of itself, I think, needs to be challenged. I think we don't really know how much of these certain micronutrients we need to make sure DNA repair enzymes are working, to make sure our tumor suppressor genes are working,
Right.
to make sure that all our antioxidant,
Right.
our, all those pathways that need these micronutrients are getting their cofactors, that they
Right.
need to work
Right.
optimally, or, to at least be working as we're aging.
Right.
So I think that's, if we look at something like a blood panel and we go, well, we're not deficient. Well, based on what? Based on the short-term function? Based,
Right.
we don't know, right?
Well, yeah, but at the same time, we also don't know the consequences of overnutrition. And we get a massive excess of a biologically active compound that's and levels that we never would have seen in nature. And we've seen it with vitamin E, we've seen it with vitamin D, we've seen it with some of the other ones. So the question is here, first, if we stop thinking about our diet as a daily thing and start thinking it as a lifetime thing, then things change because there may be things that are very much something you do. I mean, you guys are in prime reproduction time. So to get, fecundity to go up and be more fecund, we want to increase essential amino acids. We know that things like methionine, whatever, increase fecundity. At the same time, where I am, which I'm done with that process at 51, that I want to make sure that I'm longevity, and they're also negatively associated with longevity. What I feel like where we are right now, the science and things that we can be doing in the next decade is taking this body of knowledge, and yes, we can start peeling the onion more and more and more and more mechanistically, and now we've spread that to all the blogs, and they're peeling the onion, but every now and then they, cut off and forget half of it. They just sort of put these technical words out there. But how do we bring it back to look at something more comprehensive? How do we look at health span? Before we lengthen life, we need to lengthen health span. And I'm saying that if we look at if I'm not deficient, the average person thinks if they go without a meal, their metabolism's going to crash, for example. Right? So, and this will be we'll finish with the micronutrients, but we'll go to the macronutrient, I mean the macro level. But if they think that by skipping a meal something's going to happen, or by somehow not including some food group or something in every single meal that somehow they're going to be deficient, You know, the ubiquitous, you know, my you know, the evil words I've told you before, protein, carbs, and fat, I hate them. If you get on my blog, you'll see why. But, you know, no one's going to be deficient in protein, really. And if they're going to be deficient, it's going to be in one of nine amino acids, essential amino acids. We know what they are. And we've studied them quite a bit. And, you know, the fact of the matter is that for the average person out there, we also know that those nine happen to be connected to longevity too. And no one's looking at that part. So my point is, looking at this more of a as a spectrum. So originally we looked at diet because of the economics of food and the scarcity of food. If you don't have enough, it's great that every single thing meets a certain minimum, right? So when these rules of eating were developed, and we can look at some of those later, because I have all those USDA guidelines from the turn of the century, which are just fascinating. Because they actually said why they did it. And today they have different reasons, but they say the same thing. And that's kind of spooky to think about. Mm-hmm. We've made up new reasons for the same explanations. But anyway, if you look at what they said, if you think about it, the average person was spending 60% of their income on food. And when you're in a situation where you have a limited, if we look at this as a budget thing, more people may relate to, if you're at a budget and you're barely making enough each month, every dollar counts. But the value of $100 to me and a billionaire is still $100. So the point is that every dollar counts the closer you get to what you're meeting your needs are. So this idea of balanced meals and balanced diets and balanced nutrition always being deficient came in a time when people really were deficient. Deficient enough to see the diseases that we've identified. Now what you're saying,
their gums were falling out because they're getting scurvy.
Right. Yeah. And where you're at, and I am too, is okay, now in addition to that, not necessarily what are we deficient in, if I change the language and say, what more could we get at the micronutrient times, the phytochemicals to maximize and optimize our longevity? You know, there isn't any perfect diet. We're not designed to eat anything. We can eat everything, and that's why we spread everywhere. But I think somehow this construct of food and the construct of the balanced meal and the construct that it happens in a single setting versus spread out over days or weeks, where I think the body is, it's much more rational to me to think that the body deals with it over days and weeks and doesn't become deficient instantly. I think that's where the tension needs to focus. And there's really no money right now to be made in that. I can't sell somebody something. I can't sell them more supplements. I can't sell them more training. I can't sell them more exercise. And so it's kind of a trap, but I think there's people like you and I that, and some of the collaborators I'm working with, yours too, that are just intellectually curious about it. But we need to bring it back to whole food. We're going to bring it back to food and say, what can we get out of what we have? And then what's left over to supplement?
Right.